Hello. More and more streaming platforms are offering Dolby Atmos as part of their streaming services these days. You can get it on Amazon, Tidal, and most recently, Apple Music. Now, Dolby Atmos is actually a surround format, but you can also listen to it on headphones. And I made another video where I demonstrate how that works. If you're interested, I'll put it in the description below. In this video, I want to focus on one of the things I'm probably more excited about, even than the surround and immersive capabilities of Atmos, which is the improved dynamics that we're seeing in those mixes. Pretty much any mix that was done in Dolby Atmos that you compare to the stereo version of that will have better dynamics right now. And this is a fascinating opportunity to compare how those releases might have sounded if they'd been released with more dynamics originally. So in this video, I'm going to show you some examples so that you can see what you think and talk about what the reasons behind this are. So let's get started. So here we've got three songs that I'm going to play to you as a comparison. And in each case, I have the Atmos version from Tidal, and that's a binaural fold down of the full Atmos mix, as I talked about in my previous video, and the stereo version to compare with. We need to be careful when we're doing a comparison like this, because the Atmos mixes are entirely new mixes. They're not just the stereo mix with some extra processing on it. In each case, an engineer will have gone back to usually stems from the original mix and been given the stereo mastered version as a reference to match to make sure that they have been true to the original mix. Even so, because the whole idea is to get extra spatial content into the Atmos mixes, there are always going to be some subtle differences between the mixes, even when you listen to the stereo fold down, as we are in this case. And if you're wondering why, given that, there is this big difference in dynamics, the simple answer is that Dolby specify that music masters should be supplied at an integrated loudness of -18 LUFS. And that is essentially a technical requirement. Remember that the whole idea of Atmos master files is that they can be played on a multi-speaker, multi-channel surround system and also folded down to a binaural stereo signal for listening on headphones. And when you think of the range of possible systems that that audio could get played back on, it's impossible to predict and control for every situation what the final levels will be. So it's important to have enough headroom in the mixes that those changes can be made without any adverse effects on the music. And what that means for the people mixing is that there's simply no requirement to add heavy limiting unless it's needed for creative purposes. So I've tried to pick three songs here where the stereo and the Atmos binaural mixes are as similar as possible to get the fairest possible comparison. So we have the stereo mixes here at the top, and we have the Atmos mixes here at the bottom. And you can immediately see that the waveforms look very different, but I would be the first person to tell you that it's a mistake to try and judge how something sounds by looking at its waveform. So let's take a listen. I will start with the Tidal Atmos version of Ed Sheeran's latest song. And I think you'll agree, up till now, they sound very similar. I should say that all of these examples have been matched using the integrated LUFS loudness measurement, which is exactly the same system that would be used on Tidal or YouTube or Spotify if loudness normalization is enabled. So it's very much a real-world comparison of these songs. Let's keep listening. And now I can hear a difference. As the music builds, the drums in the stereo version start to sound flatter and much more held in. And when I switch back to the Atmos version, I'm hearing much more life and punch and snap in them. And if I take you to the end, which is the loudest section, I think you'll be able to hear the same thing. There are some subtle differences between the two mixes, as I'm sure you can hear, but for me, that's a fairly clear-cut example. These versions of the song are measuring exactly the same, but when played back, the Atmos version for me clearly has the edge. The bass sings more, it sounds bigger and fuller. So that's one example. Let's now take a listen to No Time to Die by Billie Eilish. We'll start with the tidal version.
That I've fallen for a line. You were never on my side. Fool me once, fool me twice. Are you dead or paradise? Now you never see me cry.
And again, I think in this quieter section of the track, there's not a huge difference, but let's now take a listen to the end. I'll play the Atmos version first.
To learn that I'd fallen for a lie. You were never on my side. Fool me once, fool me twice. Are you dead or
now here is the stereo version.
To learn that I'd fallen for a lie. You were never on my side. Fool me once, fool me twice. Are you dead or paradise? Now you never see me cry.
So, as the waveform suggests, in this case, there is much more build in the Atmos version. It gets louder, it gets more intense, and unfortunately, there's some pretty obvious distortion in the stereo version. If you didn't pick that out immediately, I'll just flick between them so that you can hear a more direct comparison. You only have to look at the dynamometer display over here. So, this section is the Atmos mix, and this version here is the stereo mix. You can see how much more crushed that ending is. And I think I should say, the Atmos version itself, we can see and hear some limiting. There's some pretty heavy dynamic control going on in the mix there as well, but it's nothing like on the stereo version. Let me just do that comparison for you.
Thank you.
I mean, that final note in particular, if we start with the Atmos and then switch to the stereo. There are some big tonal differences there as well, but I think some of those are going to be caused by the dynamics processing. For me, the Atmos version wins out. And finally, let's look at this Coldplay example. Interestingly, this is the first one where actually I feel like at the moment, the stereo version, even though they are loudness matched, is feeling more upfront, more present, which maybe that's a good thing. But now I'm feeling like it's held in. I don't feel like that chorus section there really hit in the way that I personally would have liked it to. Let's see whether it's any different in the Atmos version. And that's a pretty stark comparison, I think you'll agree. There's so much more fullness and width in the Atmos version. The stereo version feels really reined in. And again, when we get to the end where the song has really kicked off. If you just listen to the bass line. In order to achieve that extra loudness, that extra peak level crush on the stereo version, so much of the bass has had to be held in. And that's the consistent theme that I'm hearing. These three examples, as I say, are ones where I felt like the mixes between the Atmos and the stereo weren't too far apart, but I compared over 10 different songs and all of them had these same qualities. I mean, there's another example here that I can give you that's not as well matched, but has similar differences between the versions. This is Good For You by Olivia Rodriguez. Quite a different EQ there, quite a different overall tone, but again, for me, the drums in the stereo version are just held back, reined in a way that we don't hear in the Atmos mix. Now, this is where I need to say, of course, we can't say for certain where these changes were made and to what extent they were artistic choice. In most cases, right now, these Atmos mixes are being done after the fact, and I don't know for these examples whether the artists were present for the Atmos mixes of any of these, whether they got approval of them or not. I'm sure all of them approved the original stereo mixes and masters. And we don't know whether these changes were made in mastering or in mixing. What we can say is all of these Atmos mixes will have been made from the same stems as the stereo mixes and masters. So it would have been possible to make stereo versions with similar dynamics to these Atmos mixes if people had wanted them that way without significantly changing the sound. I think you'll agree that despite the differences in dynamics and some of the tonal differences between those Atmos and stereo masters, they weren't radically different. The Atmos mixes certainly weren't missing anything that was there, any particular quality, any X factor or magic ingredient that was there in the super limited stereo versions. What I do think is interesting is that I've been speaking to several engineers who are very busy right now making Atmos mixes for major labels. And one comment that keeps coming through is how much the artists love the results when they get to hear them. Several people have told me that the most common reaction when people come to listen to these Atmos mixes is to have a huge smile on their face and to be delighted with the results. Now, some of that, I'm sure, is the fact that they're in a room with 10 or more speakers in full surround sound. But I also can't help wondering how much of that might also be due to the extra dynamics that are present in these Atmos mixes, to hearing the bass sing out, to hearing the punch and snap in the drums and the extra space that those dynamics allow. I'm sure the spatial element has a significant and important role to play, but I also feel that the dynamics are going to be contributing to that impression as well. And I would love to hear more stereo mixes and masters with the kind of dynamics we're hearing on these Atmos tracks. And I think my final comment is just to say, when I'm commenting on dynamics, I often hear from people that the highly compressed, heavily limited sound of these stereo masters is exactly what the artists wanted. And whilst that might be absolutely true, I can't possibly say that it isn't, because I wasn't there, I wasn't working with those artists, I didn't make those decisions. I can't help wondering if they had been given the choice between mixes and masters that sounded like this, or mixes and masters that sounded like this, they might have made different, more dynamic choices. So there you go. I hope you found that useful or interesting, and I really hope that you enjoyed the extra dynamics in those Atmos mixes in the same way that I did. I'm really optimistic about this. I think the more people who get the opportunity to hear both versions of these songs, the more we'll realise that a lot of their enjoyment is actually coming from the extra dynamics that are in those Atmos mixes as much as the spatial elements, especially if they're listening on headphones where the benefits of that are more limited. And I hope that this creates extra enthusiasm and demand for better dynamics throughout music. I really hope that artists get to hear these mixes and understand the extra opportunities that are available to them if they choose to have mixes and masters made with more dynamics, now that everything online is being normalized so that being super loud isn't an advantage, and getting your dynamics into the sweet spot, the perfect balance of loudness and dynamics, really can be a win-win. It sounds better and it will sound just as loud as everybody else. What's not to like? If you enjoyed this video, please check back for more like it on similar topics, subscribe and click the notification bell. My name is Ian Shepherd. Thanks for listening.